Okie dokie. So we are now moving on to the fourth physics, which he nicknames Lazy, and I think he walks that back pretty quickly. In fact, right off the rip. But I would also say that it is a very bad way to think of fourth physics as lazy, because fourth physics types can be quite energetic, simply because they are indifferent to labor, so it can be very easy for them to just work and work, and they can just be very energetic people, and easily, easily take orders for manual labor. So we'll get into that in any case. But the term lazy should not be taken too literally. It reflects not so much a manner of behavior as a person's psychological orientation. On the contrary, outwardly, fourth physics often looks like a big worker. She is assiduous, undemanding, fearless in wasting energy, and efficient when within the exact limits allotted to her. Laziness of the fourth physics does not lie in the visible manifestations of sabotage, simulation, or shirking, but in the invisible indifference to the nature and results of one's work. If we mean by labor its purely physical aspect. Of course, given the obvious indifference of a lazy person to his work, it is difficult to expect passion, initiative, creative outburst, and anything else in the same spirit from him. But this indifference also has its own positive side. It is easy to assign any dirty, tedious, or meaningless work to a lazy person, which is still in abundance in our society. Someone must fill out forms that are obviously doomed to destruction. Take out pots, meaning like, chamber pots, stand at the conveyor belt, and a better candidate for performing such work than fourth physics cannot be found. For myself, I also call the fourth physics Moon Man. Indeed, the lazy guy has some kind of mysterious connection with the moon. You breathe the sun, I breathe the moon, Akhmatov admitted. I can only assume that the feeling of an internal connection with the moon in the fourth physics arises from their energetic relationship. Just as the moon shines with weak, only reflected light, so the lazy person, according to the law of the fourth functions, is only a reflection of higher autonomous physical energies. Okay. I really shouldn't read these after I brush my teeth because my mouth is just like meh. The fourth physics itself is a born decadent in the literal sense of the word, decadence, decline. The feeling of weakening of the physical principle lives in the lazy person from birth. However, it does not bother him much. Another thing is that the feeling of early decrepitude in young years, usually for fourth physics, sometimes contrasts strangely with a fresh, healthy appearance, introducing confusion and bewilderment into the environment. And just before he continues, I will say that at least my one of my friends who's fourth physics, he's very philosophical. He's also at 1V, and he just has this kind of like belief that the physical world doesn't matter. Like it's kind of just this, the physical world is like this kind of, garbage heap, and it's not very interesting because of course the spiritual world is, very is has his full attention, and what he believes we should all be directing our, minds to, and he just kind of sees like he doesn't really get the point of being engaged with the physical world. To him, it's just like an obstacle that as soon as it can be, as soon as the obstacle can be overcome, it's like, okay, done. Like that's done with. Like he doesn't really seem to get enjoyment out of processing the physical world at all. It's like something where, he's just it's kind of this mentality of there's nothing new under the sun. Funnily enough, they were just talking about the sun and moon, but like there's nothing interesting going on in the physical world, and almost as if like the sooner the physical world just goes away, the better. And that is exactly what he's explaining and will explain further here. In this regard, I recall an anecdote from the life of young Alexander Bloch. A group of Moscow poets were waiting for Bloch to come to them for the first time, and having read such lines as, "Only here do you breathe at the foot of the graves, where once I composed tender songs, about a date, perhaps with you, where for the first time you breathed distant life into my waxen features, breaking through the grave grass." I imagined him emancipated, thin, pale, and even rather ugly. The reality showed exactly the opposite. Andrei Bely recalled, "I was shaking all over. Never in my life, neither before nor since, have I experienced such burning awkwardness and disappointments. Deception, deception. I was deceived. This is not Bloch, not my Sasha Bloch." But how beautiful he was, tall, slender, stately, curly of hair, all as if in a halo of golden rays, ruddy from the frost, in a student's frock coat, broad-shouldered, with a wasp waist. His blue collar made his marvelous eyes seem even bluer. How beautiful, how earthly, healthy, heavy. Of course, the inexorable passage of time gradually blurs in the lazy person the contradiction between the mental self-awareness of physics and reality, until by old age the fourth physics does not become adequate to itself at all. But before that, such obvious contradictions irritate and shock others, making them suspect an element of posturing in a game of decadence in the behavior of the fourth physics, which in reality is not the case. She is decadent quite sincerely. Yeah, again, it's like decadent as in kind of looking away from the material world and kind of, anticipating some other. Because, of course, with fourth physics, it's like the material world is like the bottom of the barrel. Right, they're all logic, volition, emotion, they're all higher. So for fourth physics, they're like looking towards something else beyond the material. And with decadent societies is this kind of feeling that like the good things have already passed, and the engagement with the physical world has this kind of like meta quality, right? So continuing on. I had ascetic taste and did not follow the ascetic path. Berdyaev wrote, and this philosopher's phrase contains the entire economic program of the fourth physics, or rather the absence of it. The lazy man really gets by with the bare minimum, but this does not mean that he is disgusted by luxury. He is too indifferent to the physical layer of life to take seriously the problem of his personal level of consumption, which is determined more by circumstances and environment than by the desires and efforts of the lazy person himself. For example, Einstein, having secured the most basic income for himself in his old age, could use a check for 15 grand from the Rockefeller Foundation as a bookmark. That's pretty funny that he would do that. Yeah, and I just want to say that, I think, well, I don't know. Again, I don't know if I want to open this can of worms, because it should be something I should, kind of sit down, think about more systematically, and then present as a separate video. But I kind of get the feeling that really, like, fourth physics is probably they're probably the more natural, like, I don't want to say communists, but fourth physics types have this feeling that, like, nothing in the material world really matters. So if you're spending time, and of course they oftentimes project that onto others and onto their political views. So they're the ones who might say, like, really, like, money doesn't matter. For third physics, it's like, no, money does matter. Like, it does. Like, third physics types are like intensely interested. So I just the idea of that kind of like lackadaisical communism where it can be very being very indifferent to the realities of physics and kind of like head in the clouds, like that kind of like communism or material economic philosophy, that's more appropriate for fourth physics. Not for third physics. Like, third physics are more neurotic about the material world and about economics. So yeah, again, like my thoughts are not fully formed here, so I don't really like giving them out for that reason, but yeah, there is something there. Okay, Lazy is an absolutely fearless creature. The reckless courage of the fourth physics from the outside looks like remarkable virtue, but in fact it is not such. Substitute the fourth function, i.e. what you value least, is okay, so it's no great feat when you don't care about whatever your fourth function is, right? So for fourth physics types, it's no great feat for them to be indifferent to physics, because that's just their psychological nature. In addition, like any virtue, the courage of the lazy man has its downside. Not sparing himself, he is not inclined to spare others. Therefore, the fourth physics is often no less bloody in his activities than the first physics. Fortunately, violence in the arsenal of the lazy man is the last argument, and not the first. But if it comes to it, then one cannot expect mercy from the fourth physics. A recent example is the policy of President Bush during the crisis in the Persian Gulf, when, having exhausted all other forms of influence, he coldly, calculatingly, and methodically dealt with the Fourth Army of the world. Right. And yeah, that connects fourth physics to its complement, the first physics, and it's in line, which is generally the kind of like cruelty and decisiveness of the results-oriented positions. But I would agree also that fourth physics types can be very courageous. I would say, in fact, the Pente 1V types, so for those of you who know nothing, who happen to be weirdly watching this video somehow, and your interest has been maintained up to this point, the Pente 1V types would be the VLEF and the VELF, basically the 1V 4F types. Those, I think, are the most like traditionally courageous types, because they have first will, so confident volition. They are very driven and determined to like get the goal, and at the same time they're indifferent about physics, and so they can be more indifferent about physical pain and injury. So yeah, I would say probably the most courageous types are those two. By the way, a lazy guy is a win-win politician. Being a brave man, he moreover does not risk breaking his neck on what a politician's neck usually breaks: money and women. He is protected from these temptations by nature itself, by its fourth physics. Therefore, courage, lack of silver, and unshabbiness in advance provide politics with a fourth physics, with an indefinite carte blanche for the crowd. Let us remember in this regard the lazy Robespierre, whose title nickname, Incorruptible, guaranteed his stupid bloody regime an unacceptably long life. And I should also add, regardless of your opinion about Adolf Hitler, it is true that he did not allow money, and like he was not Hitler was not like out for riches. He was not like a he was not interested in material or luxury. And in fact, he was like some pretty courageous in regards to like injury to himself, and especially during his service in the First World War. And he also, he did have there were some interesting issues he had with women. However, he made it a point in his like public persona not to have a really an official wife, kind of like left it open, and he would not let like female philandering tarnish his image. So that's another example of, and again, 1V 4F type, and it's just a good example of that kind of political savvy for the fourth physics. Let us also note that the period of rule of a lazy politician is not the best time for the country's economy. Fourth physics cares too little about the physical layer of life to deal with it seriously, and this circumstance has a positive effect on the rating of the lazy politician and a negative impact on the wallets of his voters. Yeah, I agree with that. I think Fourth physics, not only can they create an image that they are indifferent to wealth and that they themselves live in poverty or live meagerly, and I think many of them market themselves like that, and also that is true, but also they can just spend money willy-nilly and not really be too interested in thinking about the practical, in-depth, nuanced implications of their spending. I don't want to scare anyone, but fourth physics is more suicidal than anyone else. For her, the thought of suicide is not a pose, as for the third physics, but something ordinary, something that regularly pops up in the mind, without causing either horror or disgust in response. The thought of suicide is the first for fourth physics, and strange as it may seem, a normal reaction to conflicts, problems, and inconveniences of life. Actually, it is generally in human nature to begin solving emerging difficulties by turning off the fourth function. So it is hardly surprising that, having found themselves in a difficult situation, the first thing a lazy person does is rush to lather the rope. And that makes sense with them being like courageous in the traditional sense of being courageous, towards physical harm, right? To themselves. From the outside, such an action looks heroic, as happened with the suicide of Socrates. But essentially, there is nothing heroic in the voluntary shutdown of what you value least. Every physics foreowner should keep this in mind before pulling the trigger. The thought of suicide is a normal, lazy whim, and one should not rush to succumb to its first wrong impulse. Right. Fourth physics is usually pretty. It's just as attractive as first physics, but in a different way. If the first physics is good for its richness of forms and colors, then the fourth physics is, on the contrary, good for its subtlety, pallor, and refinement. To clearly imagine the difference between the beauty of the first and fourth physicists, it is enough to compare the appearance of Marilyn Monroe and Marlene Dietrich. Do you feel the difference? They seem very similar. Both are like kind of like beautiful blonde women. But what Monroe has is full, rough, and sweet. Dietrich's is subtle, dry, and tender. And I looked at her picture, and I do get what he's saying. So there you go. More often than not, a lazy person is a thin bone person, an asthenic person. However, among the fourth physics, I also came across people of large athletic build. The only thing that almost completely makes the appearance of the fourth physics similar is the iconographic subtleties of the features: a thin nose, thin eyebrows, a small, narrow-lipped mouth, if there are no Afro-Semitic ancestors. A remarkable property of the beauty of the fourth physics is also that time has no power over it. I won't say that wrinkles and bald patches bypass the lazy person, no. But excluding those, the appearance of the fourth physics from youth to old age remains unchanged. And if they talk about someone, adding an old literary cliche with traces of former beauty on the face, then you can be almost sure that they were talking about fourth physics. Suetonius wrote about Emperor Augustus. He was handsome in appearance and remained attractive at any age, although he did not try to preen himself. So kind of like an effortless longevity of attractiveness. There is one more external sign of the fourth physics. This is sadness, which is more often read in the eyes of a lazy person than other feelings. Fourth physics is born and dies with a feeling of the original tragedy of existence, with a feeling of misfortune. You know, sadness is something that is close to me, Gauguin. Only when grieving do I feel solidarity, Brodsky. Expectation of a catastrophe, forebodings are typical of the fourth physics, and the words nightmare, horror, sadness, melancholy are its are favorite in its vocabulary. Here we come to a new and most interesting topic in psychosophy, the combination of various functions. We'll talk about the in so I think here he's It's kind of like actually a new section, but I'll include it here. I'm not a huge fan of his theory here, But yeah, this is actually kind of moving on to a new section. So we'll talk about the influence of the physical principle on a person's attitude and worldview, more precisely about the combination of physics with emotion and logic, and to be completely precise about what is commonly called temperament. Let us make a reservation right away. The term temperament from Hippocrates to the present day has acquired such a layer of interpretations and modifications that hardly anyone can now answer the question about its meaning with complete certainty. The only things that remained unchanged are the names of the four types into which humanity is divided according to temperament: sanguine, choleric, phlegmatic, and melancholic. Everyone seems to agree that temperament is somewhat dependent on physiology. The terms themselves denoting temperament come from the Greek meaning of blood, lymph, bile. This is the first one, so not sure what that means. And okay, that was his first like explanation. And second, looking at the classification of temperaments from a purely everyday kitchen level, it can be represented as follows. Sanguine, Rabelaisian, cheerful, life-loving person. Phlegmatic, a person who is no less life-loving, but restrained in expressing his love of life. Melancholic, not exactly a lover of life, but in any case, a calm nature. Choleric is bilious, not calm and not cheerful. Let me emphasize that this is a kitchen scheme, but we have to proceed from it because outside the kitchen, endless contradictions and squabbles begin among interpreters and modifiers of the Hippocratic typology. So I'll intervene here and kind of give my own really quick theory, and you can be the judge of whether my version is better or his version is better. But to me, like, these classic temperaments actually parallel the positions. So the first position is somewhat choleric. I mean, the way he described it, not so much, but it's like with cholericness, there's sort of this like negativity towards others, but this kind of assertiveness, right? This kind of like self-belief strength, right? And then the second position seems to me to be quite sanguine. I mean, if you go through all the second position functions that he goes through, it's like they all seem like quite like sanguine, like social, right? Socially active and dialogical and kind of like cheerful, right? And then the phlegmatic to me seems to be like the unbothered or indifferent. Because when you describe someone who's phlegmatic, it's like someone who's kind of indifferent and calm, right? And then melancholic, melancholy is like this kind of inward-looking, neurotic, kind of like anxious temperament. That's how it's usually described, right? It's like painful, melancholy. And that seems to me to be the parallel to the third position. Like all the third position types have a certain melancholy. I mean, that's the scheme I'm going with, but let's see what he has to, what, let's see what he's conjuring here. Knowing all this, let's now try to look at the theory of temperaments through the prism of psychosophy. As is known, the sign of any reliable universal concept is not the negation, but the inclusion of previous systems. And I agree very much with that, and that's what I plan to do for my own take on psychosophy and typology in general. Newton's physics became an integral part of Einstein's physics. The same happened with Euclid's geometry after the appearance of Lobachevsky's geometry, etc. In fact, the theory of temperaments is an integral part of psychosophy. The fact is that the four temperaments are four main combinations of physics and emotion, where the position of physics reflects their essence, color of the worldview, and the position of emotion at the levels of the functional hierarchy determine the intensity of expression of the worldview. And I just want to say that, you can just take his theory and remove the labels of sanguine, phlegmatic, etc. And he might here still be saying something valid. I just don't like him using those labels when I think they're better off being used as a parallel to the positions themselves. So continuing. It has already been said before that sadness predominates in the mood of the fourth physics. This is its sign. Everything here is true, but not all. The whole truth is in the system. The lower a person's physics, the darker the color of his worldview, and vice versa. The higher physics stands, the lighter the color of the worldview. Emotion is responsible for the intensity of color, for resonance, and therefore the higher the emotion, the more strongly this dark or light-colored worldview is expressed, and vice versa. So that's kind of interesting sounding. Therefore, through the prism of psychosophy, this system of temperaments looks like this. And I don't know why this is so spaced out here, but, you know, it's very possible that there's, you know, just crap missing here. But anyway, sanguine, physics at the top, meaning the one or two positions, and emotion at the top, meaning one or two. So that would be FE types, you know, 1F, 2E types, and 1E, 2F types. So that would be a pronounced light color worldview. So a very strongly colored and light colored worldview. Okay. Phlegmatic would be physics above plus emotion below. And that would be a weakly expressed light colored worldview. Okay, so physics above, emotion below. So F-E-types and F-E types and -F-E types and -F-E types. So, melancholic. Physics below plus emotion below. So that would be weakly expressed dark-colored worldview. So that would actually be the so-called adept club types, which are VLFE, VLEF, LVFE, and LVEF. And then the choleric types would be physics below plus emotion above. Okay, so I don't even want to go through these again, but I know that's like ELVF, EVFL, VEFL, and VELF. Interesting. Wait, there might be more than that. Yeah, I'm definitely missing some types in here. Whatever, that doesn't matter at all. You can extrapolate, but I probably missed some types in here in some of these, but you can extrapolate and figure it out yourself. But melancholic is a weakly expressed dark worldview. So somewhat dark, but not strongly so. And then choleric is pronounced dark, just like dark and like blah, blah, blah. Just as the position of physics influences the worldview, it also influences the worldview. Okay. So probably there was two different words that got translated to worldview in English, but whatever. The difference here is physics comes into combination with logic, but the result naturally is the same. Although it must be admitted that these combinations have not received such a detailed typology as the theory of temperaments, the typology of worldview exists in its rudimentary form and is known to everyone. This is the division of humanity into optimists and pessimists. Since enough already has been said about the influence of physics on coloring, I think it will not be difficult for the reader to guess that high-ranking physics painted in light colors gives rise to optimists, while low-ranking physics painted in dark colors produces pessimists, and nothing can be done about it. The process of forming a worldview does not depend on a person at all, and one must put up with them just as one has to put up with the weather. So, it's weird because you mentioned logic would come into this, but I don't see anything about logic here, and it would be kind of sad if like each of these had like a nice fat paragraph to go with it or something, or even like a picture. But I don't have that information, so that stinks. So I'm going to end it here. and we'll pick up on the will section.